If you're going to just abandon like a day-to-day job for the sake of like purely like artistic or creative endeavors,
You're gonna have to suffer for years and like work 60-hour weeks.
you need some kind of nest egg, and you also need to like dedicate your life to this one thing that you've settled on doing.
And also be good.
And you got to be good, and you also got to be willing to do it for free for literally years on end.
Art, well, not art. You can work your way up in commissions, right? But like art, music, modeling, just like all of those things, it's like
Podcasting.
podcasting. It's like, hope you don't like money. Welcome back, listeners, to another episode of the Laser Comb Podcast, your favorite podcast for two 90s kids comb through classic television with a fine-tooth laser. I am one of your hosts, Neo Cal.
And I'm the other guy. The
Siege. Lay off the beans, Siege. Guess what?
Anyway.
Guess what? We're
Yep.
reviewing Detroit Metal City.
This is episode 34 of the Laser Comb Podcast.
34 of these?
34 of these.
Woo!
That's we're creeping up to the number of episodes of years that I've experienced in this cruel earth, in this cruel world, in this cruel and unforgiving existence.
Oh man, you would make a great He-Man villain with that voice.
Fun
Like some
fact,
sort of insectoid.
I actually was a vocalist in a couple of metal bands when I was a teenager.
Nice. So you've perfectly nailed all the techniques not to ruin your vocal cords.
Yeah, let's go with
Let's go
that.
let's go with that.
That technique just usually involves drinking booze beforehand. Hard alcohol, straight from the bottle,
Works
baby.
like a charm.
Works like a charm. Anyway, as you may or may not be aware, this is Patreon month 2, Electric Boogaloo, and
Oh yeah.
we are trucking along with that, and we are on to our Patreon subscriber Lewis. His pick was Detroit Metal City, an anime from the mid 2000s, like 2006, 2007 ish, somewhere around there.
2006 through onwards.
Right.
Let's see.
Only lasted
Oh, it
till.
was released on DVD in 2012 though. So
Oh.
it's got that going for it. Oh, sorry. Original Animation Studio was released on DVD 2008 and Blu-ray December 14th.
Right, but I think the show aired in like 2006 or 2007
Yeah,
originally.
you're more familiar with it. I knew about it. I didn't know it was an anime.
Right. I remember this show actually kind of making the rounds in the internet metal scene back in like 2007, 2008 or so. So I was aware of its existence. It was so familiar to me that I was actually a bit surprised to discover that this show is kind of obscure. And when I say kind of obscure, I mean it well, it wasn't available on anything to watch. Not the n none of the usual channels.
Yeah,
And
just see, we have different strengths. My strength is I'm really good at finding obscure websites with sketchy streaming available. And Siege's strength is he has all the streaming services. So with our powers combined, we could usually find a way to watch literally anything.
we can usually discover access to some things. And well, if all else fails, we can always sail the seven seas, if you know what I'm
Oh
saying.
yeah. Or sometimes do that anyways, just for fun.
No,
But
I don't I don't content not content. I don't condone typically I don't condone piracy, but in the case of something that's not available otherwise,
oh yeah.
by all means, because At that point, that person is just becoming an archivist.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it belongs in a museum.
Hey,
like at that point, yeah, you're preserving it.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. It's that piracy just becomes preservation at that point.
Yeah.
Anyway, this is episode 11 of Detroit Metal City.
What do we know about Detroit Metal City? It was a manga.
Yep.
Looks like it had 10 volumes, and that came out in, let's see, original release was May 29th, 2006.
Right. So the anime came pretty quickly. And then, lo and behold, I discovered reading Wikipedia just a few minutes ago, I might add, that there was a live-action film based on it as well that came out in 2008. Had no idea.
Yeah.
So from the manga being published in 2006, within 2 years, it had a 12-episode anime and then a live-action film adaptation. It's kind of wild.
That is kind of wild. It's as long as there's a good, even if it's niche, if there's a loyal following for things, there's some money to be squeezed out of a franchise.
Right. Yeah. So yeah, Detroit Metal City, I was aware of it. Anyway, let's get into talking about the episode.
We're aware it existed, but now we're actually watching it.
Yeah, now we're actually watching it. And one thing I want to say about this episode in general, and it kind of taps into this, I find, it kind of taps into this very, like, metal elitist, like, anti-hip-hop attitude that was something that I could kind of vibe with, specifically at this point in my life, like in the mid, in the mid-2000s. But it also doesn't, it's also kind of satirizing just how self-serious metal can be.
Yeah.
Like, you get that right from the intro alone. Like, from the intro, you get this very, like, kind of Morbid Angel sounding theme song. But, like, if you look at the translation of the lyrics, they're very, like, over the top, just ridiculous, like, trying to be hardcore.
Yeah, exactly.
To the point of poking fun.
Poking fun of itself. And based on the episode list here, it kind of looks like there's an interesting tale to be told, right? Like, based on the episode title list, like Satan, real legend, pig / drug, frustration, masochist / family, punk 1 and 2, the Tower of Confession, cinema 1 and 2, fake /
cinema
Detroit,
1 and 2,
fake Detroit Moe City, hip-hop 1 and 2. So it's as it's clashing with against other genres, it looks like it also explores things like, you know, drugs, family, identity, and
right. I like to imagine cinema 1 and 2 is just about the main dude just going to film school.
Okay, now we're self-inserting. Here, which is fine.
I was taking film studies in university at this time.
So basically, this is Siege went to grow up in Japan, this is his tale.
Basically, I kind of vibe with this protagonist a little bit.
But when we get into it, like, the episodes are like 12 minutes.
Yeah.
Right. But when we get into it, man, this is kind of shockingly real and wholesome. Because we kind of like look behind the curtain, so to speak.
Yeah, a little bit. The episode definitely with the protagonist's plight in this episode, you kind of get a sense that he's that this image that he has, and indeed like the image of a like front man of a metal band, it's very performative.
Yeah. Oh, of course. And indeed, he's just kind of like seems like a compassionate and soft spoken, like just regular Joe outside of his shows.
Yeah. Yeah. I got kind of like nerdy, like, mousy vibes from him.
Yeah. And,
always the quiet ones.
If you want to launch into the actual episode, basically it starts off with the protagonist, kind of thinking to himself, like, oh man, like, I don't know if I have time for this. It's expensive. Like, drop it. But how do I tell my bandmates that? And like, very human things. This is kind of the opposite of Metalocalypse, in which they're always in character and they're like otherworldly beings of stupid but powerful.
Yeah.
This is just a dude walking home with groceries. And what's the main conflict here? Some beef.
When you talk about things being real, incidentally, one of the I mentioned I was a vocalist in a couple of metal bands when I was younger.
Yeah.
One of the bands that I was in, I did harsh vocals, like death growling and like screaming and all of that. But I made a point of writing lyrics that were just about regular, ordinary life, like just really mundane things, like being short on rent, like failing a test at school, and like just that sort of thing.
Being in line at the grocery till and the person in front of you like wants to pay and like rolls of change.
You got some like druggie in front of you who's buying like $60 worth of ice cream and yogurt and baked goods, and they're paying in like rolls of nickels,
which the cashier has to crack open.
Oh yes.
The true pain of existence is what you're capturing there.
Anyway.
And I dig that sort of like message. And indeed, what's the message going on here? Oh, he comes across the protagonist. You know what? I'm just gonna bring up his name here. I had just watched it, but I had forgotten here.
I watched it a few hours ago, so it's not quite Krauser, fresh in my mind.
Right? Oh, Soichi, right. So Soichi plays Krauser. That's his stage name, right? And he's got a devout following. And he is kind of stressed about this ongoing feud between an indie hip-hop rapper and his band.
The impression is an old childhood friend of his.
Oh, no, it is, because when he comes across him at a late night like restaurant, he's like, oh, holy shit, dude, I haven't seen you since elementary school. And his buddy's like, oh, holy shit, dude, you look exactly the same. Wow, how's it going? And then his hip hop buddies show up right before they're about to reminisce.
Right.
And during so, he narrates his thoughts to the viewer. And there, this guy was really compassionate. He was sensitive. He was bullied a lot. And now I'm seeing some cycles going on here, right? And they were like super like tight. But then he had to move.
I like that there is one bit in this episode that really made me laugh out loud. Was there's this bit in a convenience store where the main dude has like a flashback thinking about like his memories with this like hip hop guy, and like he's like getting bullied for like being fat and everything. Yeah. Like that. And it's just like this scene, like it's presented in being like this really like wholesome like manner, but like the one dude's actually like being treated like shit. And then it cuts back to the main dude and he's just like, ah, nostalgia.
Yeah, he's like, ah, nostalgia. Yeah, because like what one person might think is like funny or just, oh, what are you gonna do, might be like traumatic.
Yeah.
for someone else.
Yeah. And so his buddy has kind of has built up this image, much like the main dude has created this kind of false image that he is like this like demonic like metal lord. This other guy has created this false image that he is like this gangbanger from New York,
and that he grew up in New York even though his family's from Japan, and now he's back and the district they're in is his home. And
yeah,
he's gonna kick these, and he's freestyling. I think he freestyles some insult to the waitress. He's like, yo, hey, where's my food? I ordered it 10 minutes ago, blah blah blah. And it doesn't yeah. translate well into a lot of the English, but
his shtick is he freestyles in almost every scene, like yeah. almost all the time when he's talking to people, which I found kind of amusing.
And his little lackeys, his like faux friends, as soon as they show up, he maintains this like facade, because he's like, oh, who's this guy? You want us to get rid of him? And right. Soichi's like, actually, we're like childhood friends from, and then he's going to name drop the town they're from. Yeah. And he's all like, oh, it's cool. He's one of my old homies.
Yeah, yeah.
And they have a little moment there where as they're leaving, he turns back and he's like, hey, buddy, that guy that you knew, he's dead. Like, this is who I am. And I have to run with it.
Yeah.
Later, man.
Props to the because the version that we watched was fan subbed, so the yeah. subtitles weren't done professionally, but during the freestyling bits, like, the translation like doesn't always work, but props to the person who did the fan sub, because like they at least tried to still make it rhyme.
I was going to say they tried to make it translate into English, which means it's not going to be direct.
Yeah, it's not going to be direct.
But like, props, like you said.
Yeah, they tried
doing God's work, doing Satan's work,
doing Satan's work.
And what goes on here? Oh, shortly after that, a bunch of metalheads, a bunch of fans,
yeah,
end up like running into. I can't quite
isn't there one bit isn't there one bit where like a bunch of metalheads are like kicking the shit out of someone?
A bunch of metalheads are kicking the shit out of a bunch of the hip-hop fans, and it's gone from music dissing each other to the fans fighting each other in the streets.
Yeah.
Now here's the thing. Soichi, he actually doesn't like conflict or fighting, and he's right. like, I need to think of something like quick in order to like stop them from fighting each other. I don't have my outfit, my costume, like with me, but I do have my makeup bag. you remember this?
No, I don't actually.
So what he does is he quickly throws on his wig and puts on makeup, and he goes over to a parked car, puts his head over the top of the car, and acts like he's just Krauser's severed head.
Oh, right, yeah, because I remember when he shows up to the rap battle, the episode culminates in a rap versus metal yeah. off a rap battle, and he shows up, and I remember them he ends up showing up as like a body with no head,
because he couldn't pull his armor, his like set
because he couldn't get his armor all the way over his head, and everyone in the crowd is just like, fuck yeah, that's he's so fucking metal, he's walking around without a head, he truly yeah, he is does, a he, fucking demon
he's a
man.
Demon, he doesn't even need a head. And this corroborates his super fans earlier, who was like, oh, the only reason we didn't like waste these other like hip-hop losers was because like Krauser's severed head showed up on the top of a car, and he was like, hey, keep it on the stage, losers.
Yeah.
And like, see, here's proof, right? So he's accidentally building the mythos of his own
right
character. So, and I actually really appreciated that level of comedy.
What I really like about this episode is you have these two groups of like hardcore fans, like the hardcore metalheads and the hardcore like hip hop fans, and they're like so vigilant in what in the music that they listen to, that they actually get to a point that they're willing to fight one another. But the people, both of the figures that they idolize, are both posers. Very much, like 110%, like both Soichi and the other guy, they're both like straight up posers in what they're doing.
Oh, yeah, like even to the extent, like what his best friend, the rival, the hip hop rival, he says he's like grew up in New York, but like his family right. spent a summer there.
Yeah.
Right. Like he doesn't even know English. and Indeed, so, himself, like this guy barely maintains the facade, and he refuses to like let anybody know who he is out of the stage.
Right. So I appreciate the irony there that people are like willing to go to war with one another for the musical scene that they're in, but like their figureheads essentially are just posers.
And not only that, their figureheads like kind of don't even want to keep doing it, right? Like so right? Ichi's like, he's ruminating and he's kind of like, oh man, I can't leave because my friends are like doing it, but I want to go to school, but I need to make money, there's no money in this. And
yeah,
he's right, so it's just funny how hardcore fans can be versus
maybe he should start a Patreon.
Yeah, start a Patreon, man.
Start a GoFundMe.
The future is now. Yeah. And he's trying to make it as a Japanese idol, dang it. But it's hard in the Japanese metal verse.
What are those? It starts with a G. I can't remember what it's called, but like those Japanese idols. It's like magazines of Japanese women in like bikinis and cosplay and whatnot. Starts with a G. I'm gonna look it up.
We're going in.
Doing some legitimate there's so much journalism.
Weird stuff about. There's so much weird things about like Japan. I can't even begin to. And I say that in a great way. I was like, gee, geisha? People making money as geishas? I mean there are, but yeah, while The Siege is doing legitimate journalism here, like I said, these are like 6-minute episodes. They're kind of like on to the tail end of other television shows usually.
I'm probably butchering their pronunciation, but gravure models. Gravure. Gravura models?
Gravure models. I spelt it wrong for sure. Oh, gravure
models. That's what
are models
thinking.
Who pose in provocative swimsuit and lingerie photographs and photo books marketed towards men, similar to pinup models. Man, okay, so side note.
but before you go on, the reason why I know this is because actually a lot of Japanese Joshi wrestlers also do this.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. Gotta. Why not? And why not? Right. Do you remember when this is like shots fired, but do you remember when like half of our like female Facebook friends were really into pinup and doing like photo shoots and getting paid and exposure?
Yeah, that was really in like the mid 2010s.
Maybe more than half. Like, and okay, almost, again, all, not and shots all... fired, but everyone we knew was a pinup model, and everyone we knew was into belly dancing.
Yep.
What else am I missing? Burlesque. There we go. Burlesque, belly dancing, burlesque, and pinup.
Yeah, that was the holy trifecta of. Chicks in Victoria in the mid 2010s.
I'm not complaining. I'm just
saying. Not complaining, but I do find it funny though that like going back to their Instagram pages and whatnot, like they've all like either deleted all of their photos and or like deleted their Instagram entirely or haven't updated anything in like 3 years.
Oh, because they had a separate one for their modeling. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's just like kind of something happened around 2017 that just everyone dropped that like a hot potato.
Yeah.
Shit is time consuming and doesn't pay the bills. Me with any of my hobbies.
Shit is time consuming, doesn't pay the bills. All you get are likes on Instagram and a bunch of dudes just sending you DMing you dick pics.
And you're like,
is it worth it?
Is it
probably
worth it?
Not.
Yeah, and the people that can go somewhere with that, it's just like music. It's nice if you can put all of your energy and work feverishly day to day to do it. But if you don't have money already saved or a partner that can support you or live with your parents, et cetera, like, ain't nobody got time for that. The idea is, you know, like do it because you like it and see where it goes.
Exactly. Yeah,
exactly. And indeed, Soichi, he's almost at the end of his rope, it seems, because he's having some internal struggles on stage because they have a like metal like growl slash hip hop freestyle battle.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Is that what's going on at the end there?
Sorry, I'm going to minimize that tab for now. I got a little distracted by my Google search.
WWE Gravure models.
I got a little distracted by my Google search a few minutes ago.
I was like, he's looking at WWE like swimsuit calendars. Not that there's anything wrong with that.
I read it for the
titter.
I read it for the days of the year, god damn it.
Yeah, how else am I gonna know what day of the month of the year it is?
Right?
There's no way.
I don't even know what day it is today.
I wouldn't even look at the calendar. I mean, I specifically buy provocative calendars because I'm a very, oh, right. Completely forgot. I'll ask Siege. I am really good at improv. I'm really good at whipping things out on the fly. I'm bad at remembering shit. And having a physical, like real calendar rather than like a phone count. I don't know why I'm terrible with phone calendars or like one on the computer. Having a physical one is really helpful for me.
Mm.
Because I can walk by it in the kitchen, see it every single day and go, ah, like, you know, laser comb podcast. Ah. Dentist is coming. This is coming.
So you walk by and see a photo of a sexy lady in a swimsuit and you're like, ooh, oh, wait, I got, and then look down like, oh, I got this to do today. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, yeah, the logic is sound.
I'm glad you agree.
I should start doing that myself.
And indeed, like anyone listening to this, I don't even think I was going to be like, oh man, maybe it's an ADHD thing, but having something that's physical, that's there. Cause here's the thing. You go to the bathroom multiple times a day and you go to the kitchen like multiple times a day. And when you keep seeing, oh, right. Recording at 2 PM. Oh, right. Like dentist next week at Wednesday. It's more real and you don't have to remind yourself to look because you're going to look anyway, especially if,
Especially
if there's wrestling babes on the calendar or pretty cool dragons. I don't judge.
Hikaru Shida in my kitchen. Yeah. All day, every day.
Yeah. So there's a tactic for you neurodiverse people out there. At least it works for me.
Mm-hmm.
What happens here? Where were we? Detroit Metal City? Like I said, we're going a little bit of everything here. We're talking about in broad strokes because you know how Krauser defeats his hip hop enemy?
Go on.
They were childhood friends. He knows all the things what the bullies called him and his like nicknames and the time he shit his pants in second grade. And indeed, the person he uses that to his advantage, and the hip hop guy's like, holy shit, is this guy a demon? Like, how does he know all, like, can he read minds? And then his fear kind of goes away and he's like, wait, what if this is my childhood friend? And in a hilarious turn of events, instead of using his knowledge of his friend to his advantage and taking him down a notch, he like breaks character and he's like, hey man, like I actually think that you're like my friend Soichi and I never forgot about everything that like we went through and everything you did for me. See? And he takes off his like hoodie and he's wearing the t-shirt that his classmates from elementary school got him when he moved, and it's really tight, it barely fits. It's got like pictures of mushrooms and it's basically like good luck, we'll miss you or something like that on it, and tears well up in his eyes and he's like, it's as if he's ready to step away, because he admits to everybody, he's like, hey, I'm actually from Japan and I'm tired of pretending I'm somebody who I'm not. Not Soichi. He's like, you fool. And he actually like takes his gauntlet and he like grabs and slashes the shirt off of him, like leaving him like shirtless and like teary eyed and like humiliated. And as he's falling backwards, he's like, oh, I guess it's not my friend. And in episodes with, they're like, oh my God, look at Krauser. He's humiliating him. And all of these like hip hop bros in the audience are like cringing, because it ends with Krauser leaning down and spanking their hip hop idol. And he seems to like it. Like, he's crying, but like he's also not resisting. And I'm like, okay, this is wacky. This is weird. They're like, he's dominating him. Yeah.
And at that point, it's just like, okay, I'm out. You're one of two things. You're either like, all right, I'm out, or please continue.
I was going to say this becomes like, yeah, he's dominating him. And I'm like, kind of looks like he's liking it. And nobody's leaving. It's like that freaking Scooby-Doo meme with all the people like frowning or looking scared, and it goes over to Fred and he's just like smiling with his like eyes wide, and it's like, that's my fetish. Humiliation, check. Death metal, check. What's it called when you're in front of a crowd?
Exhibitionism.
Voyeurism is peeping. Exhibitionism is being the person that wants other people to look.
Yeah.
There you go. Every little laser comb episode, people, we try to bring kink awareness to the viewer. Just a little at a time, so we're not cringe.
Weren't we talking about latex nuns on something recently?
At this point, like, it's basically canon that we always have to drop some sort of like kink awareness.
It's not my fault. I'm Catholic, damn it.
Yeah, it's ingrained in us. It was bad no-no points when we were young, and now we gotta run with it.
Anyway, that was the episode.
That's the episode, yeah. And any closing remarks, or I think we covered everything there.
Yeah, I think we got it.
Think we got it. But I do have one question for you.
Uh-oh.
Detroit Metal City.
Right.
Would you tune in next week?
No. I had fun with it, and I stated earlier in the episode of the podcast why the things about it that I enjoyed, but there was kind of nothing to it, and that's the big problem, is like, and it's designed to be comedic, so I get it, but there was just a little there was too much of a lack of substance.
Yeah, with these small strips, there was something called Azumanga Daio, I recall, and I could never get into it because the length of the story was never interesting. But they're based on just 4-panel like daily, like shoujo jump strips, and it's just supposed to kind of be like the funnies, like, right. You look at it and you go, ha, and then you move on. And whenever those are made into anime, they run the risk of being kind of like, especially low budget, something you watch in just 6 minutes to go, ha, 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 and don't think much more on. But
yeah, it's just, yeah, too insubstantial.
There's a balance here, though, but because it's so short, I think I would, you know, like tack this on the end of like Metalocalypse, and
and both of those shows are about like 12 minutes long an episode, so they would be a good double feature in a half hour programming block. Yeah.
So both together, yeah, I'd check it out.
All right. All right, that was episode 34 of the Lasercomb Podcast. Best way to support the show, go to patreon.com/lasercomb, LAZORCOMB. We're starting at the $5 and up tier. You get hours upon hours of bonus preamble audio of this and all of the other shows that we do week in and week out, of us kind of shooting the shit before we get into recording the episodes proper. You also get a monthly commentary track. We just did one for 1986's Highlander. That was a lot of fun. And at the $10,
yeah, it was.
It was, yeah. I think that's actually my favorite commentary track that we've done so far.
Yeah, because it's so slow moving in beats, and it's so easy to talk over that it just, what a joy. What a right. joy that was. Come, subscribe and give us another like 80s movie to watch.
At the $10 Patreon tier, you get our weekly-ish news and current events program, Lasercomb Tonight. And you also, much like Lewis did this week, you get to pick a show for us to review a random episode of on this very podcast. So if you want to get in on that, patreon.com/lasercomb. Follow us on Facebook, facebook.com/lasercomb, or you can follow me on Twitter. I am at lasercomb. Cal, you are at?
And I'm at NeoCal, NEO_KAL.
We are continuing on next week with our Patreon themed month of Patreon sponsored shows. So next up on the docket is our Patreon subscriber Bemused Horseman, and the show that he pitched us was Warehouse 13.
Why does that sound familiar?
It was a sci-fi network show in the late 2000s. One of my exes,
we were hanging out in person,
right?
And you were talking about Warehouse 13.
Yeah, I've caught an episode here and there. It was a show one of my exes really, really liked. So that,
yeah, I recall now.
So I'm going to hit screen share, and we're going to go to Wikipedia to see how many episodes Warehouse 13 had. 64 episodes spread across 5 seasons.
Holy moly.
So random number generator. Old Faithful. So one number is between 1 and 64, and here we go. 37. In a row? oh boy. We landed on season 3, episode 12, Stand, part 2.
Oh, what? Why is it an oh boy? Are you familiar with?
No, it's just we're landing on part 2 of a 2-part episode.
Oh, and it looked like the first part wasn't even in that season.
No, it was the episode before it. It just had a different title.
Oh,
but it looks like it was still a 2-part episode. So that's
I'm sure. Well, here's the thing. I'm just gonna throw this out here. Reroll when it's a 2-parter.
To give
it justice, or what would you?
I kind of want to see how this turns out. Oh.
Say we're anything but definitely experimental.
We're in more ways than one.
I like it when we make jokes together.
All right, so
that's the subtitle of the Lasercomb podcast. I like it when we make jokes together.
All right, so we will be back next time with episode 35 of the Lasercomb podcast, where we will be talking about episode 37 of Warehouse 13, Stand, part 2. And until then, I've been one of your hosts, The Siege.
And I'm NeoCal.
Thanks for listening. We will catch you next time.